Well, good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Thank you.
Welcome to our legislative briefing on connection. My name is Laura Poskin, and I'm the director of Age Friendly Greater Pittsburgh. First, I would like to thank our fantastic hosts. We have AARP Pennsylvania. And we have Southwestern Pennsylvania Partnership for Aging. So this month marks 1 year since our action plan was accepted by AARP and the World Health Organization. Connection is one of three focus areas in the plan, and here's how we describe it. We envision a region that supports one another. It's understood that we're better when we move outside of our age silos and come together to enjoy life. We celebrate the power of relationships that build bridges across ages and life experiences. We all can attend shows, take classes, and join the causes that we believe in. And we all have the option to participate. So connection is an important topic, and we are thrilled to have experts here today to talk about it. It's also a deeply personal topic. I came to this work thanks to a series of friendships that helped me see the world differently. There was my pup-up, my grandfather. He picked up the phone every single time I called. And that's rare, right? There was Arthur, my friend in New York. He was in his 80s and I was in my 20s. A volunteer program introduced us, very similar to the one that you'll hear about today. We used to take the city's paratransit service to the theater as often as we could afford. And then there was Estelle, who was my neighbor when I was little. We had a lot of older neighbors, and my parents really made sure that we knew them. When Estelle moved to a nursing home, we became pen pals. So the age-friendly movement is about making our region more inclusive and respectful of all generations. And you know, that starts with us. It starts with all of us that can decide what kind of neighbors and friends we can be. So thanks for joining us today. We will welcome two more speakers up here, and then we're going to kind of get cozy and have some conversations and really meet some of the people that are bringing age-friendly projects to life. Now, it is my pleasure to introduce Joanne Grossi from AARP Pennsylvania. She is the state president.
Good morning, and thank you. I'm really happy to be here today to be part of the discussion on connection, both professionally and personally. My 88-year-old father is one of the 12 million Americans over the age of 65 living alone. And like many older Americans, he wants to live alone. And he can do so because I cook for him, I clean his clothes, I clean the house. But not only that, he actually has what this action plan talks about. He has the friendly neighborhood which offers support. So he has a neighbor who comes in and mows his lawn, and another neighbor who takes him out for breakfast or lunch every now and then, and another neighbor I know I can call if I called him that day, and after 6 hours I didn't reach him and I'm panicked, you know? So it works for him because he does have that neighborhood which offers support in addition to the caregiving I give him. But not everyone's as lucky as my dad, and so that's why the discussion we're having here today is so important, because we want to make sure that all the older Pennsylvanians have the support they need so that they don't live in isolation or experience loneliness. So we have really important discussions to take place, so I'm not going to speak any further. We want to get started. But first, I want to acknowledge the many elected officials who came out today in support of this. So first, I'd like to introduce State Rep. Alex Sarah Inamorato, State House District 21. Yay, please stand. Congratulations. Pittsburgh City Controller Michael Lamb. Councilwoman Darlene Harris, City Council District 1. Councilwoman Erica Strasburger, City Council District 8. Councilwoman Joanna Bolden, Borough of Dormont. Mayor Nicole Nesbe, City of Duquesne. Jordan Ball, representing the office of U.S. Senator Bob Casey. And Abigail Lutton, representing the Allegheny County Comptroller's Office. Well, thank you again. Thank you to all the elected officials who came out and their staff. We really appreciate it. I think it demonstrates how important this issue is. Okay, so thank you very much for allowing me to make those few comments and for allowing AARP to be a supporter of this really great initiative. I'm going to pass it off now. Thank you.
My name is Elaine Malik. Before I get into some of the data-based information about social connectedness, I'm going to give you a brief personal story. Try to bear with me. My parents had four children in rapid succession, and so since my mom worked in my dad's business, we were taken care of by extended family. I had the good fortune of being cared for by my great-grandparents. Egg, my great-grandmother's name, was strict but fair and loving. My great-grandfather was frail. He had diabetes, had no hair, had no teeth, and I don't ever think I saw him walk. He sat in a chair with blankets over his lap. But when I would arrive for my extended visits, he would do the same thing. He'd turn to Ag and he'd say, "Put the song on. Put the song on." And she knew what that meant. She'd go over to the Victrola, and I don't know if there's anybody here who knows what a Victrola is. You get extra points. For those who don't know what that is, it's a record player that doesn't use electricity. It has a hand crank on it. And you'd crank that sucker up, and then you'd put the needle down. Now, if you cranked it a little too hard or too fast, it sounded like the chipmunks were singing, right? But Ag knew how to do that. And she would do that. She'd put the record on. And I'm not going to sing it for you, Grant. You don't want to know. You don't want to hear that. But I'm going to tell you the first lines. You are my sunshine, my only sunshine. You make me happy when skies are gray. You'll never know, dear, how much I love you. Please don't take my sunshine away. Very kind and loving great-grandfather. One night he had a good dinner, decided to top it off with a piece of blueberry pie, lapsed into a diabetic coma, and passed. Egg died within the year. What they gave me was priceless. They gave me a strong belief in myself, belief that I was loved, but they gave me something else, a strong and enduring belief in the value of the older person. So when I heard Age Friendly was coming to Pittsburgh, I said, I need a voice at that table. I need to make sure that the emotional and social connectedness between older and younger folks is part of the conversation. So I'm here to talk about the value of social connectedness. And I'm going to do my best to impress upon each and every one of you that this has to be part of every conversation. Before I do that, I'll tell you real quick who I am. I'm a licensed clinical psychologist, a certified dementia practitioner, and a grief counselor. I'm on the board of SWIPA on the Social Inclusion Committee. Surprise. But why does social connectedness have such importance? What is it that makes it so important? Well, we really have two ways that we talk about connectedness. Talk about being connected. It's a buffering effect against two very serious consequences. First one is being connected at the community level prevents social isolation. Being connected at the heart level prevents loneliness. They are not the same thing. They are not the same thing, but they do overlap. They do overlap. And I'll talk a little bit later, not too much later, promise. A key piece of what they share, okay? But let's talk about some of the serious consequences of social isolation and loneliness. It's been found to be as serious as smoking a half a pack of cigarettes a day. It has the same burden on the body as obesity, and it increases the perception of pain. Remember that for later, because that's really going to be important. It decreases ability to be independent. And I'll talk again about an AARP study that shows that. It increases mortality by 2.5 times. This is not just a bad feeling. It's not just a bad feeling. Yes, most generations have a problem these days, but we talk about its impact on the older, more frail individual. It's been called the hidden killer of the older person, the hidden killer. What's taking this person's life? Unfortunately, a third of the people over 65 and half of the people over 75 live alone. 5 million admit the TV is their main source of company. The TV keeps them company. It's linked to the onset of Alzheimer's, heart disease, and depression. This is the issue that connects the two, this issue of mattering. Now, there's 5 key components to mattering. I'm only going to talk about the one because I think it's more important when we talk about program development. It has to do with this issue of being dependent upon. I want you to think about that. When we give services, and those are good services, and I'm not suggesting that services and activities for senior centers and what aren't important, but the key piece here is, does the senior believe that their participation raises the value of the relationship in the community? They have to feel like they matter. If I'm there, does it make a difference? And if I'm not there, does anybody care? So this critical piece of social isolation and loneliness, when we address it, we have to think about, do we create a sense of mattering? Now let's talk about AARP's study. Back in 2016, they did a study that launched the campaign Connect to Effect. They proved it's a public health issue. About 1,600 surveyors, 43% of them stated they were lonely. It's associated with a decrease in independent activities, climbing stairs, walking, dressing, bathing. Think about that for a second. Here's a person, increased perception of pain. We talked about that earlier, right? Not being able to do the things that they want to do because of this, right? The likelihood there's a premature transition into a facility, right? They're already feeling like they don't matter. 25% of people who enter nursing homes die within the first month. First month. Think about that. We're already lonely. We're already having incredible pain. We can't take care of ourselves. 80% of people want to what? Age in place. They want to age at home. And they're being told you can't stay by yourself, you have to go. You wonder about that 25%, don't you? You wonder. Loneliness in the health system, they interact. We see a system cluster. When a doc sees loneliness, pain, depression, and fatigue, they have to start asking questions about the person's connectedness. Social determinants of health is a phrase that's been used last couple of years. It's a big term that providers are starting to look at as we try to keep healthcare costs down and outcomes up. And they're starting to recognize the significance of these social determinants of health, it's called. 70% of the individual factors related to healthcare outcomes have to do with social determinants of health. Only 30% have to do with healthy choices. This list, you probably can't see it, don't worry about that. What I'm trying to say is the first two lines, clinical status and healthcare status, that's only accounts for 30% of the outcome, healthcare outcome. The last category, social determinants of health, those are the ones that have to do with healthcare outcomes. And what's on that list? Social isolation and loneliness. So this isn't just a bad feeling. This isn't just something that we're a little worried about. This is something we have to take seriously when we talk about program development, policy, resource allocations. We have to start talking about social isolation and loneliness because it isn't just a bad feeling. So thank you very much for listening. Enjoy.
You know, you must know this room. Thank you, Elaine. That was fantastic. Next, it is my honor and pleasure to introduce Bob Nelkin, who will guide our conversations today. Bob is the president and CEO of United Way of Southwestern Pennsylvania. His 50-year career in helping people began as a teenager in Squirrel Hill, where he volunteered with children with disabilities. This led to the creation of an award-winning weekly recreation program for children with intellectual disabilities and a lifetime of work helping people. His previous roles include executive director of the Governor's Commission for Children and Families and director of Human Services of Allegheny County. Bob, I'll turn it over to you.
Thank you, Laura. I actually have a question for all of you. So Laura's known in Pittsburgh as the most likable personality. Why is she not doing this session here? I've been, as she said, a leader in human services for 50 years. I've never been nominated as the likable person. But welcome. The room is full of great champions, of people who make a real difference in the community, and who are forward-thinking, looking at what else can we do. So we heard from each of our speakers so far today their personal connection, their concern about others in their lives. Some were family, some were friends, who they were concerned about possible terrible things happening to them as they became more isolated or more frail. But there's so much that we do, and the champions in this room are the ones often behind those wonderful things. The question today is, what else can we do? And it's a very exciting proposition. So I want you to think in the next hour about, well, that's a great example, and we're going to put some of these examples in front of you, but now, what else can we do to connect people, to make sure that lives are going great. So if we could bring our first set of speakers and role models for us all up here. Let me tell you about the first example. United Way is very proud to be part of this. Open your heart to a senior. So think about this. This is not a small program. And this is, by the way, led by community agencies, not by big organizations. So we have last year, 3,208 volunteers. 3,208 volunteers, 90,591 hours of volunteering, and they helped 9,222 older neighbors. And what do you think they did? What were the sort of things, the needs that those seniors had who were in the community, in their homes? They needed to get to medical appointments. They needed to get groceries. They might have needed help preparing meals. And there could have been chores around the house, snow on their pavement. And most of all, they needed that connection, that sense that people cared, people were checking on them, the early warning system of some problems that might need some additional attention. Wonderful program. And I think the question for all of us is, how do we grow it from 3,208 volunteers to 6,416? I just doubled that, if anyone was. And from 9,222 older neighbors to 18,444. Anyone want to check my math? So we have a great group of people to help us. We'll start with the introductions. Would you talk into the microphone and tell us your name?
Walter Jean Hill.
And where do you live?
In Broomfield.
Uh-huh. And where did you grow up?
Broomfield.
Okay. And where have you lived between when you grew up and now?
Broomfield.
Have you moved far from that original house? How far from your original house are you?
Pardon me?
How far do you live from the house that you grew up in?
Let me see. I think about 10 blocks.
10 blocks. There's Pittsburgh for you. And you know this guy?
I live on Matilda.
Uh-huh.
And I was live on Cypress Street.
Uh-huh.
I was born on Milkgate Street.
But you did not cross a river?
Nope.
Okay. And you know this guy next to you?
Yes, sir.
What's his name?
Lee.
Okay. And Lee, if you could talk into the microphone, where do you live?
I live in Friendship.
Uh-huh.
I grew up in the South Hills.
Oh, you did move around.
I did cross two rivers, I think.
Uh-huh. And you are a volunteer?
I am a volunteer, yes.
For what organization?
Open Your Heart to a Senior.
Okay. And you visit?
I visit, so you were talking about catastrophic events. I met Gene close to 8 years ago or 9 years ago during Snowmageddon. Because I was doing shoveling for senior citizens in the neighborhood.
And you come to my house?
Yeah. Sign up for the program.
Okay.
And Jean and her husband were looking to have some snow cleared out from their house because they were snowed in.
That's great.
That's what I meant.
That started it.
That started
it. And so how many years later are you still doing this?
So I'm not shoveling walks as much anymore, but I have started to do monthly food pantry deliveries.
Mm-hmm.
So there's a food pantry in Garfield, and I believe it's for about 8 years now that I've been doing deliveries to elderly residents in Garfield and Stanton Heights.
So Lee, if I'm correct in your story so far, and it's the first time I'm hearing it, you're talking about boxes of food and other important supplies.
Correct.
And they're heavy. And when you're talking about the shoveling of snow, it takes some muscles.
Yes.
You got them?
Yes. Okay. Well, I bring my small children and I make them do the hard work.
How old are the kids?
I have a 13-year-old daughter, an 11-year-old son, and a 7-year-old son.
What do they think about this volunteering?
They think it's great, especially because there's one of the women that I deliver to has an unguarded candy dish that they can raid. So
very smart woman.
Yeah.
So how many people do you visit?
Just two now.
Uh-huh.
So Jean and another woman, Sonia.
And what difference do you think you're making in Jean's life?
So I think that she...
Don't be modest.
I think she depends on the food deliveries that she gets once a month. And, you know, sometimes when the food pantry does need to be rescheduled for other reasons, you know, I can hear the distress in her voice about that being rescheduled. So I definitely think that it's something that she depends on. And I think that she also enjoys just the visit and being able to see me on a regular basis. We also see each other at church sometimes as well. So
telephone calls too.
Yep. So I think it's that, you know, the earlier speakers were talking about just connections to community. And I think that's something that I do provide.
What do you think about that, Jane? Did he say it correctly or do you disagree?
I love it.
What exactly do you love?
I love the food, the people from the food bank. I love my neighbors and my friends, my family, and especially those I don't have to ask. They just offer, and like Lee, he'll call and say, "I'm checking in." I says, "Well, I'm checking with you. Make sure I'm okay. I'm checking."
That's very interesting. So what if Lee wasn't there?
I mean?
What if Lee wasn't there? What if Lee didn't help you? How would you struggle?
Well, I don't know. I always find a way. And
okay.
then since my husband had died and my brother had died, my family helps with going to store. My And some of my friends helps me from church, goes to store for me.
So it actually is a lot of people who care and are coming forward, and it's very special. Lee, what is it that you get? So, you know, I think Jane was alluding to the fact that people enjoy helping her. What do you get, and what did your kids experience from this? That's what I want to know, besides the candy dish.
Some of the other speakers talked about people in their lives that were important to them. And I think, you know, I had a really close relationship with my grandfather and my grandmother, so, and they've passed. So I think the connections that I have with Jean and with Sonia helped me to kind of fulfill something. I really enjoy spending time with older individuals. That's something that goes back to when I was really young. So I definitely get a lot out of it, and just being connected to them and hearing their stories. And I think my kids, it's a way to show them and to demonstrate to them that this is what you do, that you give of yourself. And I think you can say that to people, but when you demonstrate it, it's particularly strong.
I love the family volunteerism. I just wish we had so much more of that. Would you introduce yourself?
My name's Sarah Papperman, and I manage the program that Lee and Jean are involved with.
And Sarah, pretty typical sort of glowing remarks for the program?
Oh, everybody loves it. Jean and Lee have a particularly special relationship with each other, but we have a lot of people involved with the program that have a really special connection to. One of my favorites is in the past couple years, there was a gentleman who got involved with our program who wanted to go for some walks because he developed Parkinson's disease. And the volunteer who wound up connecting with him, they realized that they had known each other from when they were in college. And the one was actually in the other's wedding. So through the program, they've gotten reconnected. So I think that's one of the neatest things about programs like these, is we're really just bringing people who, bringing people together who, you know, want to be connected but might not find each other otherwise.
Yeah, it's a great function. And you've got to be touched by it. So this is your career. How does this fulfill you when you see the sort of relationships and assistance that Lee can provide, you know, with Jean?
It's really energizing. In the office, we're, just taking calls and doing all of the coordination. So I really love getting to see people in person too, and to see how important it is. So there are a lot of people that really rely on the program, and some people like Jean are really fortunate to have a lot of people involved helping them, and some people are less fortunate and really rely very heavily on the volunteers as maybe their only source of support. So it's a range, and I keep doing it because I can see how important it is.
And I guess my last question for you is, so are there another 9,000 seniors out there who need the sort of support and friendship and connection? And are there another 3,000 volunteers who could provide it?
Well, I think everybody can be a volunteer, so hopefully far more than 3,000.
So what's holding us back?
I think part of it is we need to tell each other about these opportunities and tell all of your friends and neighbors that this is a great way to get more connected with your own community, and that it really, even if you're busy, it really doesn't take a lot of time.
So I guess, you know, the room is full of elected officials and their representatives. What's the message that we might have to them, how they might support the growth and quality of these connections? I threw all sorts of questions that weren't in the script. I could answer that if you want.
I think encouraging people to get involved with their neighbors and be engaged and supporting the kinds of programs and efforts that you're hearing about today, and age-friendly and...
Almost all of these programs are funded by voluntary contributions and voluntary agencies. And boy, wouldn't it be fantastic if we had some government funds that would help us connect and help everyone. That's just a thought. I never have a point of view. All my elected official friends, you know, oh, there goes Bob again. Hey, let's hear it for the panel. Fantastic. Thank you, Jean. Good. Wow, what personalities. Absolutely fantastic. So as the next panel is getting up here, let me tell you about something that age-friendly Pittsburgh and SWPA and all the partners have come up with. And that's the whole idea of transportation being a natural connection. So if you think about it, everyone in this room knows the importance of transportation connecting us from one place to the other, right? But this is actually a proposition about connecting people and making sure that the connections are respectful and that there's some dignity involved. You know, Aaron, when the state administration was looking at the transportation bill in the last administration, a lot of us argued how important transportation was because you can't help human beings without that public transportation. You've got to get people to services. You've got to get workers to their jobs so that they can provide the services. And then you have to have transportation so that people can go to the homes of homebound, either people with disabilities or seniors, and help them. So it was great in the end. It was a great debate. We almost didn't get the support, but the Port Authority, who, by the way, you're going to hear from in a moment here, did get the support so that we can keep human services going in this community. We can help human beings. I think it's a really important part. So an interesting connection here is what happens on the bus. And all of us have had good and bad experiences on the bus, but the question is, can we intentionally do something to change and make sure that everyone has a great connection on the bus? So why don't I start with you, O. Harold?
Sure.
Okay, would you state your name?
My name is O. Harold Hoots. I'm a resident of the Oakland, South Oakland section of Pittsburgh, Fraser Street. And
okay, and O. Harold, tell me about that name.
I know a lot of people ask me, am I Irish? I said somewhere along the line. Somewhere along the line, I do have some of that, I guess, in my blood.
And what did you do for a living?
I was a chef at John Cain Hospital for 20 years. And due to some terrible circumstances that happened in my life, I had to take an early retirement from there. But I've worked other jobs since that time.
And also a Zumba instructor?
Zumba instructor.
You want to get up and get us going here?
I would love to be able to teach.
You know, at Laura's very first staff meeting at United Way, I asked her to get up in front of everyone and lead us in, you know, some energetic exercises. So, and you love to dance. What type of dancing?
Oh, man, I love any genre of dance. The art of dance is so beautiful. It takes me away from all of the pressures of life, so to speak, and different things. It just gives joy to my life. It really does.
I always feel so awkward. But you don't.
God bless you.
So you ride the bus.
Oh, man. I ride the bus. I've been riding the bus for over 50 years.
50 years.
Here in the city of Pittsburgh.
Lived here in the city the whole time.
East end of Pittsburgh, mainly. And then recently, we transcended to Oakland.
Did you used to drive to work?
No. I've never driven. I've always, I've had a fear of driving, you know, and I just commuted by transportation, which is Port Authority.
That's great. And would you introduce yourself?
Yes. I am Dolores Bickle, and I live in the West End part of the city.
And where'd you grow up?
I grew up in the West End part of the city.
And how far from where you grew up do you live?
Oh, I'd say about a 15-minute walk.
15-minute walk. So more than Jean, but not across a river or anything like that.
No, still on the same side.
And you ride a bus?
Yes, I do.
And by the way, you like to be called D, is that right?
Right.
Okay. And where do you ride the bus?
I ride the bus at Ellendale Circle. Mm-hmm. And the bus stop is right across the street from my house.
Oh, that's great.
And then I can take it straight to Giant Eagles. And the bus stop is there at Giant Eagles.
Oh, that's great.
Kraft Dillingham Shopping Center.
You got everything settled here.
Oh, yes, I do.
So how often do you ride the bus?
Oh, maybe three times a week, maybe a little more. Because on occasion, if the weather's good, I'll take the bus to go to our senior center. And I get off across the street from Langley High School. And then I walk through, up the steps, and through Langley to get to our senior center.
That's great. And you don't drive.
Oh, no.
You couldn't get around without the bus.
Right.
And so when you're getting on the bus, do you ever feel like unsafe, you know, in that very first moment when you're on the bus and you've gotten on and the bus is about to take off?
No, because basically I've had a few bus drivers tell me where I live there's a sewer, okay? And being in the circle, it's like a curve. So they told me if I would stand above where the sewer is, it would be easier for them to pull in. And I do this, and then they can pull that in, and sometimes they might need to use the lift, and there's times when they don't.
Wow, think of the accommodations and the conversation and the relationship where they're helping you be safe.
Yes.
And you're helping them in turn,
right,
in terms of stopping at the right place.
And then they wait till I sit.
Well, that's the part I wanted to get to.
And then
because if they didn't and it jerked forward,
right,
you could be thrown.
Yes. And I thank them because then I let them know that I am seated.
Uh-huh.
And then they pull out.
Yeah, this is such a simple thing, but it's a big thing, right?
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly.
So let's hear it from a driver's point of view. Would you introduce yourself?
My name is Marina Randolph.
Marina. Mm-hmm. Marina as in where boats are?
Yep.
And Marina, how long have you been a driver?
About 4.5 years.
Yeah. And I saw a note that said, you think there's something special about drivers, that they have to love people.
They do. You have to have a love for all people to be a bus driver.
could you say that again? And can the camera zoom in on her eyes? Say that again. Say it again. Go ahead.
You have to have a love for all people in order to be a bus driver.
And the other big quote that I heard was something about God's way of testing your patience.
It is. Sometimes you have to be careful what you pray for. Because it can come in many ways. And definitely being a bus driver teaches you a lot of things.
Are you a character?
A what?
Are you a character?
No.
You have a little bit of personality.
I do.
Yeah. So tell us what you think about what you just heard from O'Harold and Dee, and what drivers and the Port Authority and all of us have to think about the importance of these connections and the kindness that you're also providing.
It's definitely kindness. You have to treat people like you want to be treated. As far as the seniors are concerned, you definitely have to lower the step and make sure they're sitting down before you pull off. There's a lot of things that, you know, with seniors, you have to treat them, you know, like people, you know, and some people tend not to.
So. Yeah. And do you have anyone, like seniors, who ride on the bus just as an activity?
Yes, they ride. They know when you're coming. They look at that schedule. They know what bus you're on. You know, they are very disappointed when you're off that route too, but they get on and they just ride downtown, you know, and they be like, you know, just talk to you and, you know, get that conversation and tell you what they've done, where they're going, what they've been doing, you know, and you kind of know like, well, how's your kids doing or what's, you know, cause they've been talking to you for a long time. So they use the transportation sometimes just a way to get out of the house and to be out and about.
And that's pretty special. I was just thinking of a new idea, a new name for a project, Senior Citizens on Wheels.
Right.
Senior Center on Wheels is what I meant. Laura's used to my quirky humor. So let's hear from the Port Authority. Would you introduce yourself?
Good morning. My name is Darcy Cleaver.
You have to speak into the microphone there. Say it again, Darcy.
Good morning. My name is Darcy Cleaver.
And what do you do at the Port Authority?
I am the Assistant Manager of Passenger Amenities and Contract Services, and I manage, or I'm in the Service Planning Department.
And next to you?
Good morning, everybody. My name is Tony Berkeley. I'm the Manager of Transportation and Training. I essentially train all the new hires that come into Port Authority.
And you guys have a project with Age Friendly Pittsburgh, which one of you, Darcy, you want to explain it?
So Port Authority was contacted by Age Friendly about one of the components of the action plan that they were doing in regard to sensitivity and awareness to older adults, which is something that's very important to Port Authority. We provide over 62 million rides a year, and providing service to 7.5% are senior citizens. At the time when we were contacted, one of the proposals was to do some posters or a campaign to, you know, just provide some awareness of when seniors board the bus, something that can help them a little bit more. It was great timing because we were in the process of developing some digital messaging boards in all of our locations that are in what we call our cruise rooms, where the operators spend a lot of time every day. And these are boards where we put very important pieces of information.
And so what are the photos supposed to do? What are they supposed to illustrate, and what are they supposed to do?
So there was several slides that were produced. It was a very fun day, thanks to Dee and Harold and Maria. So they took some photographs. Chief Schubert was very actively involved in doing the photography.
Wait, time out there. You're talking about the chief of police, the city of Pittsburgh?
Yes.
He was the photographer?
Yes.
And go. How did you get him to do that?
Laura.
Hey, I can tell you, he was also a mentor in our sixth grade mentoring program. This is a great chief of police. Yeah, so more about the photos.
So the photos were developed to just show everyday situations and different things that we heard from the riders and also the operator, where they can work together to improve the riding experience. So there was actually, I think I said, there were six of them developed, and they're playing consecutively two each month, and we're just going to keep switching them out every month and just keep playing them.
Yeah. So why didn't you do this before, and what do you plan to do in the future?
So I can let Tony talk a little bit about that, but there are many things that we have always done, but this was just an added component to it. I just want to add, too, that we have over 1,200 operators at five locations that are seeing these every day as a reminder every time when they come in to start their day and get their corner card to go out and start their work each day.
I think it'd be wonderful if you captured the stories that, like, Marina and other operators have about the kindness that they provide, and that this is part of what fulfills her life, you know, is being kind and considerate to the individuals. And I love what the Port Authority is doing here. I think it's important to get down to those human connections. It's really fantastic. I will also add, in the few months that she's been here, I've had opportunity to meet Catherine Kellerman, the new CEO of the Port Authority. She's absolutely fantastic already on United, supporting United Way, and you guys have always supported United Way, and it allows for us to do things like Age Friendly or Open Your Heart to a Senior or the Caregivers Projects. So thank you to the Port Authority for being great citizens. And yeah, let's hear it for the Port Authority. And last word, Marino, where do you think we go with all this stuff? What should we be doing? How do we help operators and citizens interact and connect?
Educate them. But they might not be aware. They just might not be aware.
And let me use another word, inspire. Because I think it's in people's nature to be considerate. And I think if we just inspire that and reward that, that would be great too.
Yep.
We also like to stress to our operators not to lose the human element.
Right.
That we're picking up these people that need us day in and day out, and we get to behind on getting through traffic and the other aspects. So it does my heart really good to hear these fine people who depend on us and the positive message that we're doing what we need to do out there. And a fine operator like we have here today, it does my heart really good to hear that.
I
appreciate it. You guys are doing that for us. Thank
you. It does mine too. Oh, Harold, you get the last word, but then we're going to move on.
I just wanted to say, because I didn't get the opportunity to tell you how much I appreciate Port Authority.
Mm-hmm.
This lady next to me, I didn't know her name or anything. I'm not real good with names, so please forgive me for that. But I went, just last week, I believe it was, I was on a bus, and who did I see? Her. She was the very one that was on that bus right there that you see on the screen, right in the picture there. And I mean, it's just been so fabulous. I know so many great, truly, and I'm not here just to say that. There's some truly great bus drivers in this city.
I agree. Mm-hmm.
Bill Wynn, he's retired. Ron Garrett, and there's many, many others that have really been so kind to me.
Think about being able to name the operators, the relationships.
I mean, my wife and I are like, we're the type of citizens that we walk everywhere. Everybody knows us. So we ride the buses everywhere we go, and we just enjoy the rides everywhere we go. It's so such a well-rounded atmosphere. You can go anywhere in the city by Port Authority. We were just discussing the other night how you can get on a bus in Shadyside and ride all the way out to the past Edgewood, all the way out past Braddock. They just do so many great things. So I just wanted to add my.
Let's get that marketing department from the Port Authority to interview. Thank you very much. So we're going to switch up a little bit. I think this is more in the area of intergenerational connections. So we know we have one of America's great children's museums here. And when you think of children's museum, what part of the population do you think about? Okay, here's the quiz again, pop quiz. When you think of children's museum, what part of the population do you think about?
Children.
Class, nicely done. Okay. However, an age-friendly project that it was part of a competition is the Generations in the Garden project at the Children's Museum. And we only have a few minutes, but we're going to talk about that as kind of a model and example of how we can go to places in our community that are important, like the Children's Museum, and create these intergenerational moments and activities. Would you introduce yourself?
Oh, sure. Hello, my name is Laura Ramey, and I'm an educational program specialist at the Children's Museum. I was one of a four-part team, and I mostly was like the garden expert for this project.
Okay, and would you introduce yourself?
I'm Amy Dukes. I'm with the Jewish Association on Aging. I work specifically with our dementia residents and attendees.
And Amy, you were bringing a resident with you who was part of this project, but she couldn't make it.
We were going to bring two, and something came up with both of them, but they were very excited about the project and the possibility.
I'm going to ask you to channel them, okay? So think of both of them as we're talking about this. So really quickly, what's the project?
Oh, yes. So this was a collaborative project we called Generations in the Garden. We have some garden spaces at the museum, and we invited Gwen's Girls. So they're a group of tweens. So we had 15 Gwen's Girls, and then we had seven seniors from the JAA, and we brought them together over three sessions, and they worked in our garden. And we did a variety of projects.
Well, like, what were they growing in the garden?
Oh, yes. So I actually have
Excuse me. Could you show a little bit of enthusiasm?
Oh, yeah. I have some show and tell. So I actually brought some of the plants.
It's the Children's Museum.
Oh, yeah. Okay. So they planted a cabbage patch. We got a new accessible bed, so they planted cabbage together.
They planted herbs, like we have some Vietnamese cilantro and some rosemary and thyme and some flowers as well, some coreopsis. So that was some of the planting.
It's pretty cool. So we know what the result was that came out of the ground. What was the result that happened in people's soul? And Amy, anything that you can help us understand there?
We had such a wonderful group of girls as well as seniors coming together, and they really bonded nicely. Helen was one of the ladies who was going to come with me, and one of our Gwen's girls specifically just fell in love with Miss Helen. And anytime they got together, she sought out Miss Helen, which was very nice. We had seniors come with us who had been gardeners in their life and, of course, had been around children. But where our lives have taken them and where our lives take us, they're not around little kids that often. So they enjoy just being at the Children's Museum and seeing all of the kids walk past and talking about them. And then they enjoyed working with the girls and teaching them some of the things they knew from their gardening past and learning from the girls what is going on in their lives.
Yeah. So Laura or Amy, either one of you can answer this. What did the girls from Gwen's Girls get from this?
Mm-hmm. I think they saw that they could be friends with someone who is a lot older or someone very different. And I think they really enjoyed collaborating together and doing like artistic projects together.
So do you think there's like a barrier between generations? Do you think between adolescents in this case and people, I'm assuming they're 60s, 70s, and 80s? Is there a natural disconnect?
I think there could be. I think definitely maybe they wouldn't think that they had a lot in common, but we gave them some common goals in the garden, like paired them up and to plant something. So they had to work together.
You want to respond at all to that?
I think a lot of the stories we've heard from people today about why they're involved in Age Friendly is because when they were growing up, they were around seniors and they saw how important they are. But that's not true for every kid. And the way that we've had people up here who have moved 15 minutes from where they grew up.
And some less,
and that's not the case with the current generation of kids. Their parents have moved a lot further away from family, so they don't get to benefit from the multiple generations. And I think this was a great opportunity for these girls who may not have that grandmother figure in their life to really understand that they can learn a lot from our seniors.
I think it's a wonderful and poignant, model. I'm glad Age Friendly, supported it. It sounds like it was fantastic. You grew both things from the ground and things in the heart. Mm-hmm. But I guess the question is, it's a relatively small program. Mm-hmm. What's the vision going forward? How can we think differently about it? And I'm not asking you to have the answer to that, but what's the question that we want to be asking ourselves about how to bring together and connect different generations? Either of you can answer.
I think one thing I want to point out because of my personal passion is that the seniors who we brought with us are seniors living with dementia. And very often people living with dementia become isolated because they're not as welcomed into the community in this way. And if you know about short-term memory loss and dementia, you understand that there are things that are very poignant that stick in the mind even as the dementia progresses. And with the two ladies who were going to come with us, they would not necessarily be able to find their way around our campus. But every time I walk down a hallway with one of the ladies, she says, "Oh, this is the way we went when we went to the Children's Museum." And when we talk to Helen about gardening, she talks about the little girl that she really connected with. And I think that really speaks to how important it is for us to welcome people with dementia out into the community, but also how important this intergenerational program was because it helped them to develop new memories.
So I understand that, but I think the question that I'm looking to answer is, how do we grow this? How do we make this happen? And, in every organization, how do we connect the generations? And as I said when I asked the question, I'm not sure you have an answer today, but it's one that we need to answer. Any thoughts on it?
Oh, yes. I would love to work on this more in the future, just having more intergenerational programs at the museum, making it more welcome to all ages. And then also, I really believe that gardening is so great at conducting this intergenerational programming, and just having more gardens at senior centers, because older adults are really superstars in the garden. Like, I learned gardening from an older mentor, so I think that they have so much knowledge, and it really makes them shine to be outside and growing things.
I want to thank both of you, and I want to thank both of your organizations and the seniors and the girls from Gwen's Girls. I think it's a great example. And I think the challenge is, how do we take this, you know, forward? And I would say to both of you, you got to show a little bit more enthusiasm. Let's hear it for them. So we're being joined by all the participants, and looking to the audience for some questions, and I think we want you to come up to the microphone, be brief with a question, and we'll try and direct it to the right place. And it looks like Joanne Grossi, the president of AARP, and let me tell you about her as she's walking up here. We worked together in the Rendell administration. There's not a stronger advocate in Harrisburg and Washington for people, for seniors and for children and for people with health problems, than Joanne Grossi. She's an extraordinary advocate, and it's so great to have you in Pittsburgh today.
Well, that's so kind. I'm going to hire you to be my PR guy. Thank you so much. So I did, and I apologize for having to step out. It was my father who had a medical question. So I think it's so relevant to what's going on today. And that kind of prompts my question to the open your heart to a senior folks. I can't help wondering, but organizations like yours, or even Meals on Wheels, you know, not everybody has someone like my dad has to call me. So I wonder if, when you're making your home visits, is ever there a point or a priority of the program to look out to see, does the person look like they're having medical issues, or is there some diminished capacity, or you know, the state of the home is in a disrepair? I mean, do you ever, I know that's a lot to ask for a volunteer, but is that ever part of the program to look at, you know, there's times to make an alert or to see what's really going on?
Oh, it's like you set us up. So, Sarah, are you prepared to answer that one?
Sure. Well, communication is a really important part of our program, and when we enroll people in the program, we do have a staff member go visit them, but after that it really is just the volunteers who are seeing the participants in the program. So we do rely on them to let us know if they see any changes with the person that might be concerning, and then our staff are information and referral specialists as well. Okay. And work hard to get people connected with other services, and that's just with the program I work with. There's other Open Your Heart to a Senior partners, like Meals on Wheels, that this is not my area of expertise, so I can't speak in detail about it, but I know that they have an app that they've developed where people delivering the meals can indicate a change in status for someone that they are delivering a meal to.
So it's called the Change of Condition app. Mm-hmm. And Laura, maybe if you could step up here real quickly and just describe that, because it's an example of how we can do exactly, Joanne, what you're talking about, more than the meal, right?
Right.
Right.
So explain it.
So the Meals on Wheels drivers, more than a meal, they're the eyes and ears for the people that they're delivering to. So as Sarah said, this app called the Change of Conditions app, and this is something that was developed here in Pittsburgh thanks to funding by United Way. And nationwide, Meals on Wheels are taking note of something that's happening here. It's this app, so they can easily report back, and then they have someone, you know, a staffer who will contact them and make sure that everything is okay, and if it's not, they will keep following up. So it's exactly what you talked about. It's a really innovative program.
The person's weaker, confused, right. There's a pain that is persistent, not going away.
Yeah, the home's not being as well cared for as it used to be, or something.
Yeah.
And I'm sorry to belabor it, because I know other people have a question, but I wondered if the Port Authority has thought the same. Some people don't have someone coming to their home, but they use the bus. So, you know, do you have your drivers, you know, on the lookout to see if there's changes from regular riders?
So we're starting,
Port Authority could answer the question, but we're starting to extend it from the Meals on Wheels drivers to access drivers. So the paratransit service is starting to use the same app. Again, thanks to
I think where there's a relationship, Joanne, that would be the right place for that. So it's something Port Authority, let's talk about. And I think there are other places who could think about it too. It's taking whatever the service is, transportation or a meal or daycare or whatever, and taking it to the next step, early warning, connecting.
Thank you.
Great. Thank you for all that AARP does and for being the partner here. Nancy. Please introduce yourself.
I shall. Nancy Zients, Jewish Healthcare Foundation. So it's clear to me that what all of you have in common is a passion for your work and interactions with seniors, and in some cases, clearly, some personal experiences that you bring to the table. Is there anything we can do as a community, from the nonprofit sector, the government sector, to help with any training that you might need in order to do your jobs better, in order to keep up to date with what may be changing, whether that's a training in behavioral health issues, dementia, gait and walking, nutrition? What is it that would be helpful to you in order to continue to do this work?
Marina, Lee? Yeah.
That's why I was saying education, because a lot of the drivers may not know, like if a lot of the drivers would have come today and then hear and then see, it would educate them, mm-hmm. and it would make them think different, or some drivers, it would make them think differently about how they treat the driver. So I think education is definitely pamphlets, anything like the videos that we have. I haven't seen them yet, but the videos that we would watch in the cruise room when we come in, because mm-hmm. that's where we spend most of our time. Brochures and stuff on the table, right. You know, that we can read. So it would just make you think a little different.
Great, thank you. Anyone else?
Anybody else want to respond to that one?
I would like to just say that the Port Authority and Access, they've been a blessing in my life, because I and my wife have been isolated from a lot of things. Our financial situation is pretty bad right now, so we don't get out much. And the invitation for me to participate with the Access and Port Authority is just brought joy to my life. I love being able to tell a story about what's going on in my life, and they have opened up a door for me to volunteer and to come in and to let people know the good things that are being done. And the last thing I want to say is that the experience that I had with when I went to the Access program and they had the bus there, it was so unique. I've never experienced, the bus was actually sitting in a room like this. We had the opportunity to do a lot of really exciting things that made me feel good.
So, Nancy, to your question, perhaps the Port Authority is the ripe laboratory for us to actually get some discussions with the operators about what would help them, and also with some experts interacting with them. And
so I'm delighted to tell you that we're about to partner with the Port Authority to bring Dementia Friends education to all of the staff of Access and the other transportation providers, because so many of the persons that they deal with and their caregivers may be experiencing some early signs or late signs of dementia, and greater awareness and sensitivity is important. But they have stepped up, they have asked for education, but education's open to everyone. Volunteers, staff, et cetera.
It sounds, Laura, like there's another project on the horizon.
There is. It's already ongoing. Thanks.
Thanks for what you do, Nancy. Somebody else? Going once? Come on. Any of the elected officials? Any of the representatives?
Do it. Okay.
introduce yourself, please.
My name is Joanna Bolden, and I'm a relatively new councilwoman in the borough of Dormont. And I'm super excited that, where's Zita? Is Zita in here? Well, our Dormont AARP is here, and I think a real part of the leadership team, so I'm really excited about that. I was really inspired to hear about the program at the Children's Museum. We're a tiny municipality, obviously limited funds. And so figuring out small sort of incremental steps, little programs that we can try out and see if they work, I think that's probably a good direction for us to go. And I was wondering if we've got a whole bunch of people with experience here, if you had any other ideas. Gardening obviously is a good one. But if you had other thoughts on small projects that where you could start to bring people from the whole spectrum of the community together.
Who wants to jump in? If not, it's going to be you, Laura.
Well, I was just going to say, I think that O'Harold should lead some Zumba classes, perhaps. But no, seriously, I mean, I think some of the activity, and this is part of our action plan, some of the activities that happen at a senior center should be in a park, should be in a public space so that all ages can participate. And not only that people can participate, but that other generations can see everyone interacting. Like you might not plan to go to the Zumba class, but you might be walking down the street and say, huh, look at all those people having fun doing Zumba. And this is something that, you know, this is how Pittsburgh is. This is what we do in Pittsburgh and Allegheny County.
Are there any other representative of government who want to answer the question? Please introduce yourself, Darlene.
Yes, I'm Darlene Harrison. I am on Pittsburgh City Council.
Do you want me to give up the seat here?
If you'd like. No. But it was very interesting this morning to hear all of your stories. And I just want to let everyone know I'm a caregiver for my mom. My husband retired, so he... And my neighbor, it's a nurse, watches her during the day, dementia. And it's true, with dementia people, they can remember way, way back. Every time I need an answer of back in the day, I can get that off my mom. Other than that, I love you, I'll see you in the morning. But I think it's so important that I try to get out to my senior centers and play bingo with them whenever I get a chance. And it's they like it because you're their elected official. And I love what happens down the Children's Museum with the planting, and I know you two are so excited with what you do. And I'm going to have to get one of those free, I think they're free bus passes? Yes. Yes. So that I can ride around with this
D
gentleman on this bus. But anything else on caregiving, because I think that's very important. And there wasn't much on that this morning. So if there's anything else you can share, because... I know what it's like. I get up every 2 hours with my mom at night. You get used to it just like you have a baby again. But it's important on the transportation. And it's important to watch buildings such as the City County building. I recognize a lot of problems when you have someone on crutches or the little wheelie that we have down here, Mrs. Hill, or a wheelchair, of how difficult it is getting in and out of buildings, even over that little hump.
Sure.
So caregiving, helping out more and thinking about someday you're gonna be that age.
So I'll
let you go with that.
Yeah, no, I love it, Darlene. And I think that takes me to the closing comment for this part of the program. So there's so many wonderful things that have been done and so much more that we have to do. And I hope everyone has been inspired like I've been today to hear these stories, to hear these models, but it's just the beginning. And when I think about... government and big organizations like the Port Authority or Wesley, the provider of the Open Your Heart to a Senior, or United Way, I think we overstate what organizations can do and what grants to those organizations can do. And we understate the power of human beings connecting with each other mm-hmm. and really making a big difference. And if I have anything to do with it, Laura, and we talk all the time, the theme that I would use is, how do we mobilize the community? How do we get people to do things that are natural and to do things that are inspirational. But I want to thank the panel, and we're going to switch to the last panel that's going to get to what do we do next. And I've been in lots of roles in the community for 50 years, but I've always wanted to do this.
Thank you, Bob, and thank you, everyone. I thought that was a really fantastic session. It was wonderful to hear from everyone. We're going to hear from two people that have some upcoming exciting events related to connection. And I was going to start with Jason Jablin from Lively Pittsburgh, but I think that Bob's comment about, you know, just connecting with one another, being together, I think we should have Mary Fan Gruber come up and introduce a really exciting thing that they have going on next month that people can still sign up to do. It's called Around the Table South.
Thanks, Laura. Hi, everybody. My name's Mary Fan Gruber. I'm with Jefferson Regional Foundation. So we're down in the South Hills. And very excited to just mention something we're doing for the first time in our area. We're a grant-making foundation that focuses on what's really the whole Route 51 corridor and Mon Valley. And sometimes it's a challenge because a lot of the times we think more about the city and but yet we really need to be also focusing on that broader county work. So one of the things that we're doing that we are always looking for, how do we hear more deeply what's happening for residents and what people's experience is in the community? We've borrowed a project from the Chicago Community Trust that's called On the Table. We're calling it Around the Table South. And for 1 week in October, the week of October 15th to 19th, we're going to have 100 conversations happening across the community and hoping to gather the input of 1,000 voices all in 1 week. So we have recruited as a pilot a lot of different organizations. We have libraries, we have churches, we have school superintendents, we have some local businesses who are going to be hosting these conversations at their tables, and we're going to be gathering all of that information back together. When we've done a little bit of this work already, we know that one of the things that people talk about is individuals aging in place in their communities. And we all know that that's both an asset because we have wonderful memory, wisdom, and so much that older adults offer, but it's also a concern in terms of, are we age-friendly neighborhoods? So we're interested to see if those issues rise and how they rise up. We know that people think a lot about transportation challenges and how we might bring youth and older adults together. So we're interested to see how those issues come up and what we can learn from in our neighborhoods. And it's very relevant today hearing about the idea of social isolation and loneliness. We know that that's a huge challenge and it's a huge issue. And we hope that just even these small starts of having a lot of people at tables together talking about how they might make a difference in their community. To Bob's point about sometimes the difference really is a community. Even a foundation like ours and Jewish Healthcare Foundation, which does remarkable work, and United Way, which does remarkable work, we know that no matter how hard we worked, we couldn't be able to change everything, that it really does take all of us. So this is another effort to just engage more people in a conversation and connect. And we know that sometimes people just meeting each other inspire each other and start new things. So it's Around the Table South. And if you are connected in any way with the communities that are South, we'd love to talk to you about that. And hopefully you'll be hearing more about that once we collect all our results. So thank you.
100 tables. Isn't that really cool? Age Friendly, United Way, and some of our partners in Claritin are going to be part of the 100 tables, and hopefully you will be too. Now I'd like to introduce Jason Jablin from Lively Pittsburgh, who's going to tell us about another way that you can get involved.
Thanks, Laura. Thanks, Laura. Kind of cold back there. Wow, it's a lot warmer up here. As Laura said, I'm Jason Jablin, and I'm from Lively Pittsburgh. We are a social enterprise connecting residents of all ages, abilities, and demographics for a healthier, more vibrant, age-friendly Pittsburgh. Our motto is serious fun with serious outcomes. And if I've seen some faces in here that have been to some of our programming, I think they would attest that it is quite fun. But we do achieve some outcomes as well. Over the past 3 years, we've had a privilege of connecting older adults to experiences which instill a sense of purpose, empowerment, and while doing that, they're also strengthening their relationships with others, which, as we talked about today, is very important and vital. Lively Pittsburgh has helped ignite the conversation for an age-friendly Greater Pittsburgh through creative community workshops called Aging Your Way. I wish I can talk about these things a lot longer. It was just such an amazing experience to be able to view our participants and talk to about the challenges they're facing in that. We also produce pop-up street mob dances. They are called the Crossings, and if you YouTube those, you'll see an example of, yes, Sarah was definitely at one, of how exciting and innovative those things can be, and we've made quite, we've had a woman speak here about those recently as well. We also promote walkability in a collection of data and walkability in our neighborhoods. And more recently, we have worked closely with the gardening, Generations in the Garden. We support an age, a community-led project to activate plan through Age-Friendly Challenge, which awarded $10,000 in mini grants this past May. Which leads me to what's next and why we're here. I have a flower to, I think like 60 to hand out, so if you want to take one, that'd be wonderful. But on Wednesday, October 17th, we invite elected officials, their staff, community organizations, and citizens to join us for an age-friendly Greater Pittsburgh Initiative Showcase. The event will be held at, so get out, I don't see anybody writing this down. You want to get out your calendars? You are? All right, great. Get these calendars, oh, good. So the event will be held at a great facility, the Frick Environmental Center, from 6:30 to 8:30. It includes comments from our co-host, Mrs. Allman, who is a civic innovation specialist for the City of Pittsburgh, as well as demonstrations from businesses that we've worked with and projects to make our region a more age-friendly community. We would like to thank the officials for their continued partnership in making Pittsburgh a great place to live for all ages and abilities. And just briefly, I just want to talk about how wonderful it's been to work with all the organizations here, and especially, as you mentioned, the most likable person in Pittsburgh, Laura, who just does wonderful work. And I think the panel and Laura and everybody involved should have a round of applause for today, because it has been and I went off my script, Laura, and I'm sorry, but it has been an amazing journey for us with Lively, and we couldn't thank everybody enough for this inspiring situation that has presented itself in Pittsburgh, so thank you.
Okay, I'm not going to stand between you and the coffee and pastries outside very long, but I do want to say that the next time that we'll join together is November 29th. From 3 to 5, we'll be in the Gold Room, and we would love to see you there. We're going to be talking about our third focus area, which is innovation. So thank you all for being here. Go out and connect with one another, and we'll see you soon.